Hello, my name is Timothy D'Alfonso. I'm one of the pathologists here at Weill Cornell Medicine.
And I'm Justin Snow, one of the residents here at Weill Cornell Medicine.
Today we're going to be discussing the handling and grossing of a lumpectomy specimen from the breast that's been previously localized with a radioactive seed. What precautions do we need to take with this specimen?
With this specimen, we need to first identify the radioactive seed. So this radioactive seed was placed by the surgeon in order to locate the lesional tissue within the lumpectomy and allow them to remove the lesional tissue, as well as by the pathologist to identify the lesional tissue and to properly identify the radioactive seed and to properly store the radioactive seed.
Okay, so are there any additional precautions we need to take with this specimen?
With this specimen, we need to first identify that radioactive seed is present using the gamma probe.
Okay.
The gamma probe lights up, letting us know that the radioactive seed is present. And we can then cut into the specimen and properly float and ink.
So we reviewed the prior history, and it looks like this patient's had a core biopsy that showed an introductal papilloma, and at the time of biopsy, a clip was placed. We've also reviewed the specimen x-ray, which shows a clip and seed in place in the specimen. So
here is our lumpectomy specimen.
This specimen is from the left breast. So how has the surgeon designated the sutures that are attached to this specimen?
So this lumpectomy specimen is oriented by the surgeon as a short superior stitch and a long lateral stitch. So this is the patient's left lumpectomy specimen. So we place our short superior, our long lateral, this is our medial, and this is our inferior.
Okay, now we can go and designate these margins with ink.
Correct. Okay, so now we'll proceed with the inking of the specimen. For superior, which is indicated by the short stitch, we will ink yellow. For the lateral, which is indicated by the long suture, we'll ink blue. For the inferior margin, we will ink violet. For the medial margin, we ink red. And for the posterior margin, we ink black. So after we've placed our ink, what we'll do is we'll take a clean napkin and we will get off some of the excess ink. And we will spritz the specimen with acetone, which helps the ink fix onto the fat. And then we can flip it over in a clean location. We can ink the anterior of the specimen green. And touch up any ink that did not get onto the anterior surface, like the inferior. And then again, spritz the specimen with acetone. And we have inked the lumpectomy specimen.
Okay, so now to summarize, we've reviewed the clinical history. With a specimen x-ray, we've confirmed that there's a clip and radioactive seed localized within the specimen. We've also confirmed the localization of the seed with the gamma probe, and now we need to fix the specimen in formalin. Okay, so now we've fixed the lumpectomy specimen overnight, so we have a well-fixed specimen, and now we're going to begin by just making thin sections in the specimen.
Okay, so in order to put these into cassettes and have them be in pretty good size for these cassettes, what we can do is turn the specimen and orient it a little differently, and we're going to submit from superior to inferior. So we'll go ahead and make small little cuts. And there, I believe I went through.
Okay, we did hear something. It's probably a seed.
And there is the radioactive seed.
Okay, so why don't we pull that out?
Okay.
Okay, so now we've identified the radioactive seed, and we just want to confirm that that's the seed and not a separate clip. So we'll use the gamma probe to confirm that.
So it does go off when it goes over the radioactive seed.
Okay.
And we're going to scan the rest of the specimen.
Okay, excellent. So that's the radioactive seed. Now we'll properly dispose it in this lead container we call a pig. And now we can continue sectioning our specimen. Great. So we have essentially fibrous breast tissue. We've identified a radioactive seed in an area that looks to be a small biopsy site, noted by some hemorrhage here. So we can measure this biopsy site.
Okay. So the biopsy site measures 0.7 centimeters by 0.3 centimeters. And if we put both the pieces together, 0.4. So we have a 0.7 by 0.4 by 0.3 centimeter biopsy site and location of radioactive seed.
Okay, and the biopsy was done, there was an interductal papilloma on the core biopsy. Mm-hmm. We don't really see any interductal papillary lesion here, essentially fibrous breast tissue and a small area of hemorrhage indicating a biopsy site. So let's go and just submit the entire specimen, and we're submitting it from superior to inferior in consecutive sections.
Okay, so what I'll do is cut off the suture and perpendicularly section the superior margin. Okay, and then continue submitting from superior to inferior. And I'm going to separate these and put these into their own separate cassette, as this was the previous biopsy site and radioactive seed site. And then we'll continue cutting this inferior margin perpendicularly.
Okay, to summarize, we've discussed the use of radioactive seeds as a localization technique for surgeons and radiologists. We've discussed handling of the radioactive seed and proper storage. In addition, we've discussed how lumpectomy specimens are oriented, how we ink them, and how we section the appropriate areas to submit for histology. And that's how we gross these types of lumpectomy specimens.
Hello, my name is Dr. Sandra Shin. I'm Professor and Chief of Breast Pathology at Weill Cornell. I'm here with Dr. Justin Snow, who you've already met, and we'll be talking about a different type of specimen from the one you've just seen. This one is different for a couple of reasons. Justin, do you want to elaborate?
Absolutely. Thanks, Dr. Shin. So this specimen is localized with a J-wire, which the surgeon also uses to find lesional tissue in order to help him or her remove the lumpectomy specimen.
Okay, so I think that before we cut into the specimen, we should talk about kind of the pre-work that's involved in preparing for the grossing of a breast specimen. What would you want to know about the patient before cutting into the specimen?
I think with any pathology specimen, it is important to know the age, the gender, as well as the presentation of the patient and their particular pathology. For breast specimens, it's important to know, did they come in with breast pain, or was it something they found on radiology that was abnormal, specifically mammography, ultrasound, or MRI?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So do you know the story about this particular patient?
Absolutely. So this is a 72-year-old female that was found to have a mammographic abnormality, which appeared to be a 1.5 centimeter spiculated mass located at the 3 o'clock position of the left breast, 2 centimeters from the nipple.
Great. Something that did come with this specimen is what we call a specimen x-ray. Justin, do you want to describe what you see there?
Absolutely. So I see it's blown up a little bit, so it looks much larger than it actually is. But we see approximately a 1.5 centimeter soft tissue density with a clip localizing the area of prior biopsy and the J-wire, which allowed the surgeon to identify the previous biopsy site.
Okay, great. And can you describe a little bit about the features of this mass that you see in the middle?
Sure. So the mass has irregular borders. It's much more dense compared to the surrounding fibroadipose tissue.
Okay, great. So the fact that it has very irregular borders, I think, is important, and let's see if we can confirm that on gross examination. Something that has a very round border, what would you be thinking?
I would be thinking more of a benign lesion, something along the lines of fibroadenoma mm-hmm. or something like that.
Okay, great. So something that has very irregular borders, we're more suspicious of a malignancy.
Absolutely.
Okay, great. So we didn't talk about the core biopsy, actually. You mentioned that there was a clip there, mm-hmm. which is often deployed at the time of core biopsy to, again, show where the area is in case we have to go back and do an excisional biopsy, which was the case in this patient.
Right.
So do you know what the findings were pathologically for that?
I do. So the consultation service performed here at Weill Cornell showed invasive mammary carcinoma.
Okay, great. So we all already know that probably this is going to be an invasive carcinoma.
Yeah.
Do you want to bread loaf the specimen? I think that's probably the best thing to do. We can go ahead and measure first.
Yep. So the specimen in its longest axis measures 4.0 centimeters by 3.5 centimeters. By 1.4 centimeters.
So why don't we go ahead and do that?
Okay. So leaving a little bit of room with the medial margin, which we will cut perpendicular in a second.
So how thick should your sections be?
Sections should be between 3 to 4 millimeters. So this section I cut a little long or a little wide in order to cut with a perpendicular section for the medial margin. Mm-hmm. And now I'll be cutting 3 to 4 millimeter thick sections. And I'm hitting the J wire, which was placed by the radiologist for lesional localization.
Okay, great job. So at this point, probably we can take out the J wire.
Mm-hmm.
It's more important to leave it in if the area of localization is more for calcifications. But with a obvious tumor mass, I think we can take that out, which will help us open up the specimen and look at the cut surfaces of your slices. Great.
So there's our J wire. Okay, now we can look through our slices and finish the cuts. Okay, so I've changed the blade. It was dulled a little bit by the J wire. So now we have a sharp blade. And so I'm looking for my first cut on the medial aspect of the specimen. I'm gonna finish that cut. Being careful to stay straight with the margins. Here's our next cut. Finishing through it.
I think it's also important to keep it together in the sense that once you've cut the slices, that they should remain kind of stacked together so we don't lose orientation.
Okay, and so now we can examine the specimen.
I think it's important to not only look at the cut surfaces visually, but also use your finger to kind of see where the firm area of the tumor mass is.
So I do notice, Dr. Shin, that there are some irregular areas of firm, dense regions within the fiber fatty tissue, which could be lesional tissue. And also I'm looking for the prior biopsy site because we know there is a clip in here.
So this one is, I think, a nice example of probably most of the tumor mass here. You can see that there's a white area, almost has a gray-white cut surface, and you can actually see the puckering of the fatty tissue as the tumor kind of draws in the surrounding tissue towards it, and you can also see that the tissue around it is mostly fatty, which mm-hmm. helps with seeing the borders of the tumor. I think it's also important at this stage to also look at where the tumor might be approaching certain margins.
Right.
And that's something that you should include in your gross description.
So we can see that this mass is very irregular in its contour, and it does seem to approach the anterior margin quite a bit in some of these specimens. It also seems to approach the inferior margin.
I think another way to also see the borders of the tumor is to kind of pinch it to see where it starts to show some resistance So it looks like, I think your main tumor sections are gonna be these two.
Okay, and then here's our last one, which is our medial margin.
Okay, Justin, so I think that this would be a good time to locate the clip, which was deployed at the time of core biopsy.
Okay.
Do you see it in any of the sections?
I do not see it near the previous biopsy site with the needle track. I don't see it within the firm lesion, but as I continue to palpate, I do feel a firm area, and I actually see a metallic clip located near the lesional tissue.
Let's go ahead and measure. When you stack them up, did you find a measurement there?
I found a measurement. It's about 1.5, maybe a little less at 1.4.
Okay.
But within the staging guidelines, it looks like it'll be staged as the same tumor macroscopically.
But since we're dealing with a 1.5 centimeter tumor, we should be able to take a section that nicely shows the greatest extent of the tumor.
Absolutely.
So since you measured it at 1.5 centimeters by stacking the slices together, mm-hmm. It's less important to actually have that section submitted from an individual slice.
Okay.
So why don't we go ahead and put a couple of sections of tumor. I think it's important to submit wisely, in the sense that we should also take into consideration any close margins.
Right.
And if we have to trim the sections, which it looks like we have to here,
mm-hmm.
We want to trim off areas that are going to be more farther away from the tumor and include those margins that are closer to the tumor.
Okay. So by this section, we see that the tumor is very close to the anterior and inferior margins, so we definitely want to include that part. So what we could do, since this is greater than 2 centimeters, we could maybe bisect this right here and then submit them as a paired section in two different cassettes.
That's a great idea.
Okay.
All right, Justin, I think we're ready to take some sections.
Yes, I agree. So I think the first thing that I want to submit is the section with the biopsy clip. And with this section, we see that it does come close to the anterior margin. And we do get all four margins. The superior looks a little pale right now after it sat in formalin, but it is there. So superior, inferior, anterior, posterior, we're getting all four margins.
Okay, great.
So what I was gonna do is section this and pair it into paired cassettes.
Sounds good.
And so this will be 1 and 2 paired. The next section we chose was this one. And this one, it also comes close to the anterior margin as well as the inferior margin right here.
So this one actually shows a little bit more of the mass that was biopsied, so you can see the irregular borders here. And as Justin said, it seems like it's definitely abutting the anterior and inferior margins.
Okay, and so what I was gonna do with this one is also bisect it right here.
Great.
Face down. Okay, and within the rest of the specimen, I didn't see too much more pathology except for the very obvious needle track and the biopsy site changes with hemorrhage and fibrosis, but I didn't see any other lesional tissue within the specimen, so I think I'd like to submit this as a paired section with the lesion coming close to the anterior margin as well as the inferior.
Sure.
With the needle track. And then what we can do is perpendicularly section the medial margin and lateral margin and submit all.
Great, because I think that with your paired sections, we've covered 4 out of the 6 margins.
Right.
And I think it's nice to document definitely the needle track with the hemorrhage here and also the area where we found the biopsy clip. So okay. Let's go ahead and do that.
Okay. Okay, and then take the medial margin and chop off these sutures since we already know we're at the medial.
I think it's important to mention at this point that all of our margins are taken perpendicular
mm-hmm.
Because shaved margins, although they may have some purpose in other organ systems in the breast, it's very important to be able to measure the tumor to the nearest margins, and we can only do that if the sections are taken in a perpendicular fashion.
Excellent, okay. So we will proceed with that. This is our medial margin and perpendicular cuts. And we're using the same 3 to 4 millimeter cuts. It's a lot of specimen within one cassette, but we made it work. The last one is the lateral margin,
which we will cut perpendicular as well. Okay. So then we can close the cassettes.
Well, Justin, I think we're done here.
I think so too.
All right, so to recap on what we covered in this session, something different from the previous session was the fact that this was a lumpectomy specimen that was localized by J-wire. We covered the importance of clinical history, the knowledge of how the patient presented, whether it was through clinical detection or by screening mammography or other imaging modalities. We also talked about, in addition to J-wire, the presence of the specimen X-ray and how we use that both for the gross examination aspect for us as pathologists, but also to confirm that the actual area of interest was indeed excised by the surgeon. And then lastly, I think we talked a little bit about the importance of measuring the tumor grossly to the nearest millimeter, which will affect the tumor staging for patients, particularly in larger tumor sizes that exceed the diameter of what can be seen on the microscopic slide. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope that this was helpful, and thank you, Justin, for accompanying me.
Thank you, Dr. Shin.
We received several breast specimens, each representing separate margins, and then we received separate specimens that represented different margins. So when we receive these, it most likely will come with a suture that's positioned at one side of the specimen. So Justin, do you want to describe the specimen that we have here?
Sure. So this is an additional final margin that the breast surgeon sent us from the lumpectomy. And it is oriented by the breast surgeon with a suture. This indicates the final margin. And okay. So what we do is we differentially ink it two colors if it's oriented. And we indicate that the final true margin is black and the remaining portion of the specimen is green.
So just to recap, basically if the lumpectomy, main lumpectomy specimen is here, this would be kind of the peel of the grapefruit. Mm-hmm. And so the green side is actually the old true margin where it was closest to the lumpectomy specimen, and then the true final margin now is the black side, which is the outermost part of, or the surface of that grapefruit.
Okay.
Do you have any questions?
Yes, Dr. Shin. I was wondering, how do we know when to stop with the black ink as the final true margin and when to begin the green ink as mm-hmm. the margin that was taken out with the lumpectomy?
Right, so I think that's a little bit of a gray area when it comes to deciding what is the true margin based on what we ink. Mm-hmm. It's a little bit of a judgment call. I would say that the vast majority of specimens like this are received and the shape of the specimen is usually flat. Or at least elliptical, so that you can kind of see that there are two flat sides.
Okay.
Hopefully one flat side is stitched. And so we kind of go by the fact that it's a flat pancake looking specimen, and you know, you just kind of ink the that one side one color and the other side the green color. But there's no specific science to it, but
okay.
We do the best we can.
Okay.
So once we have the specimen inked appropriately, it's just like what we did with the lumpectomy specimen. We'll go ahead and bread loaf from black to green.
Okay.
And see what we have on the cut surfaces.
Sounds good. So the first thing I'll do is, now that we know where the sutures are indicating the true margin, I'll just cut off these tails and begin to bread loaf the specimen perpendicularly from black to green. And then we can lay it out, and we can see that this specimen is composed of fiber adipose tissue, but mainly a fibrous component. And we don't see anything that really looks like lesional tissue.
Right, so again, just like the other main lumpectomy specimen, you want to just use your fingers to also confirm that there isn't a localized firmness that might be suspicious for residual tumor.
Mm-hmm.
So as you said, Justin, it looks like it's mostly fibrous tissue, but I don't feel anything particularly firm. So in this case, if you don't see anything specific grossly, the best thing to do is to submit the entire specimen sequentially in case we do find something microscopically and we will need to measure. And we can do that pretty much up to about 7 to 10 cassettes. Okay. So why don't you go ahead and
put these face down and sequential.
Now, Justin, what would you do if it did not come with a stitch?
If it did not come with a stitch, there's really no way we could tell that this is a one side is a final margin. Mm-hmm. So we have to treat the whole thing as if it's a final margin and ink the entire specimen black and submit all.
Okay. So in that case, under the microscope, because we don't know where the true margin is, any malignancy or tumor that we see in the entire specimen would be considered a positive margin. Okay, great. So this concludes our section on how to gross a separate margin specimen. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you, Dr. Shin.
And I think we're going to move on to how to gross a mastectomy specimen. Thank you.
Now we will be discussing grossing a mastectomy specimen. Here we have a nipple and skin-sparing mastectomy specimen. So Justin, what types of mastectomy specimens are there?
Tim, we have a simple mastectomy, which includes the majority of the breast tissue as well as the axillary tail spence. We have a modified radical mastectomy, which includes the majority of the breast tissue as well as a lymph node dissection, and a radical mastectomy, which is, again, the majority of the breast tissue or all of the breast tissue, and lymph node dissection, as well as pectoralis muscle.
Okay, and we don't typically see those too much anymore, do we?
Right.
So what are what's the information that we need to have before grossing a mastectomy specimen? This has already been floated, inked, measured, and fixed in formalin, but there's some information that we need to have.
Right, so the clinical information is extremely important in mastectomies as well as lumpectomy specimens. It's good to know whether the patient has prior pathology results, what's the indication for the mastectomy really. And so core biopsies, stereotactic core biopsies are usually performed for diagnosing breast lesions. So that would be good to know in this patient. This patient had DCIS on their core biopsy, so a lumpectomy was performed. And the patient unfortunately had positive margins. So that is the reason for the mastectomy specimen.
Okay, so they elected to have a mastectomy after having a stereotactic biopsy followed by lumpectomy with positive margins for DCIS. Right. Now, there is some additional information. We get specimens sometimes in patients who've had preoperative chemotherapy or neoadjuvant chemotherapy. Mm-hmm. And in these cases, chemotherapy is given prior to surgery to shrink the tumor, often to make the tumor operable or to allow breast conservation therapy. Right. And in those cases, you often have a marked response and marked shrinkage of the tumor. And oftentimes it's difficult to identify any residual tumor. So what we're looking for is the tumor bed. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we only see ill-defined fibrous areas, and it's crucial to look at the prior radiology and see the amount of response that was seen on imaging and whether there's any clips placed at the tumor bed. Oftentimes there are. Mm-hmm. And we do our best to sample as much of the tumor bed as possible to evaluate response to chemotherapy. Okay, now there's no skin or nipple on the specimen. However, if there were, we would want to describe any lesions we see on the skin, any changes in skin color, any scars from prior surgery or biopsy. And the same thing goes for the nipple, if there's any ulceration, which you might see in Paget's disease, or if we see any skin ulceration by the tumor, it's important to document that for staging purposes.
Right.
Okay, Justin, so this has already been inked for us. It's been oriented and fixed. Can you just explain how this was oriented by the surgeon and how we inked it?
Absolutely. So this was received to us from the surgeon with a suture indicating the upper outer quadrant of the specimen. That is indicated by our pathologist who floated this with red ink. The anterior surface of the specimen, which is where the nipple and skin would be, is inked green. This specimen was not indicated, the nipple region was not indicated, which we would differentially ink yellow. This specimen does not have that. When we flip over the specimen, we have the posterior aspect of the breast, which has more of a smooth and shiny surface, and that is differentially inked black. So then when we place it down onto the cutting board, we again put it onto our clock face, and the upper outer quadrant of the left breast is in this direction at the 2 o'clock position.
Okay, so we are ready to begin sectioning the specimen. We're gonna section in a bread loaf fashion as thinly as possible, around 0.5 centimeters. It'll be a little bit easier because the specimen is fixed. So do you wanna begin?
Absolutely. Okay, so we'll take our large Ginsu blade, which is good for bigger breast specimens. And we'll cut 0.5 centimeter intervals, trying to keep the anterior portion connected if there is nipple and skin. But with this specimen, again, there is no nipple and skin. So we can cut all the way through 0.5 centimeter intervals. So there are a few clips that I went through in that cut.
Okay. It looks like we're in the lumpectomy cavity now.
Mm-hmm. Right there.
Okay.
So we'll continue cutting.
Okay, excellent. So we finished sectioning the mastectomy specimen. We've identified an area that's probably the lumpectomy cavity, and now we can go through each individual section and see basically what we find. And mostly very fatty breast tissue here. As we get to our area of interest, you can see that there is a cavity, which is the area of prior lumpectomy, and there's some areas of fat necrosis surrounding it, indicating prior surgical changes. So this is going to be the area where we're going to take our sections from. And depending on how large the lumpectomy cavity is, we can submit either the entire cavity or representative sections. And here is a very ill-defined fibrous area, likely fat necrosis, post-surgical changes, and scarring, but we'll just submit this. And here the surgical changes extend into the medial part of the breast. And here the breast tissue is a little bit more fibrous, but otherwise unremarkable as we keep palpating the specimen. And now also we want to make sure that there's no additional lymph nodes that we see in the axilla. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we get some lower axillary lymph nodes that are included, and we've palpated this area and really don't feel anything as far as lymph nodes. Okay, so now we want to measure any lesions that we found, as well as the distance of each of the lesions to each of the margins and to the nipple. And if there are multiple lesions in the specimen, we would measure the distance between them as well.
Okay, so we see our previous lumpectomy site, which is an area of interest. So we can measure the lumpectomy site by putting all of the pieces together. And we should note that it's at about the 1 o'clock position, located very close to the anterior and posterior. Put all the pieces together where the lumpectomy site is. And I would say that's probably the last piece right here.
Okay. 4 centimeters.
Okay. 4 centimeters by the second biggest dimension, which would be that slice.
All right. Well, that's around 4 centimeters as well.
Okay. And then by the anterior and posterior.
Okay. And that's 2.5 centimeters. Now we can see that the lumpectomy cavity appears to be abutting the deep or posterior margin and looks to be about 1 centimeter from the anterior and nipple area. Remember, this is in the central aspect of the breast. So now we will go ahead and x-ray these slices to locate the clips, so we do not submit them for histology.
So in order to properly gross a mastectomy specimen or breast specimen in general, it's important to x-ray, looking for previous biopsy sites with metal biopsy clips as well as radioactive seeds, and looking for any soft tissue densities which would indicate a previous procedure performed in this location. So we put the specimen half at a time, the outer quadrant first, the inner quadrant second. The outer quadrant goes into the Faxitron machine and we perform the x-ray. Once we have performed the x-ray, we can look at the screen and manipulate the image in order to identify any soft tissue densities as well as the metal clips and radioactive seeds indicating previous procedures, biopsy sites, lumpectomies. And then once we identify where the clips and seeds are located, we can proceed with grossing the specimen and identifying these and removing these before submitting to histology.
So now Justin has x-rayed the entire specimen. Justin, do you want to summarize your findings?
Sure. So we located the clips using the x-ray. We have marked the areas in which the clips were found on the x-ray, and we can go ahead and remove the clips by palpating, feeling where there is any firm region which is suspicious for a clip, and then looking a little closer, we can remove the clip.
Okay.
And we've already done such, so now what we can do is block out the areas where the clips were found, as well as the previous lumpectomy site.
Okay.
So this is the clip located in the lower inner quadrant. And what we can do here is bisect this to thin this section out a little bit. And so with this specimen, we have both the anterior and posterior margin of the clip site.
Okay, and I think the next step should be to block out the area of this lumpectomy cavity, so you can select your sections.
Okay, so the lumpectomy cavity consists of where we found the clip. This is the first part, as well as the portion surrounding it, which is this part. Keep on going. So it's these sections right here.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so it's a fairly large area. I think we should submit representative sections from different areas of the lumpectomy cavity and sample it pretty well, but I don't think we actually need to submit the whole lumpectomy cavity and surrounding area. There'll be too many sections.
Okay.
So let's start with here.
Start with the biopsy clip?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, and then what we can do with this is maybe cut it right down the middle and then section it into four different cassettes.
Okay.
Okay, so these next four sections would be the area of the biopsy clip and lumpectomy site.
Okay, so now we'll work on submitting some sections from these three or four slices here. And so here we can submit just again representative sections of this area. We can probably block out this entire block here and submit that. Okay, we've sampled it pretty well, but we'll just add a few more sections from this area of the lumpectomy cavity. Okay, so I'm pretty comfortable that this has been adequately sampled as far as the lesional tissue. Now we said we didn't find any lymph nodes in the upper outer quadrant, so now we're just going to be submitting representative sections of normal tissue from each quadrant.
Okay. So from our upper inner quadrant, which is this location, we can submit representative areas with both the anterior and posterior margins of the specimen.
And you want to focus on areas that are generally are more fibrous than fatty.
Right, so this would be a good location with both the anterior and the posterior. So what we can do is thin this down a little bit. And then another representative area of the upper inner quadrant, where it is fibrous. Okay, and then we'll move down to the lower inner quadrant, again looking for more fibrous areas.
Looks pretty fatty. Let's try and keep the sections that we put in the cassette relatively small here.
Okay. Okay, so that'll be our lower inner quadrant. And then we'll move on over to the upper outer quadrant, which is more towards the previous lumpectomy site, looking for more fibrous tissue. This is also pretty fatty. And so we can do representative. Okay, and then we'll move to the next position of the upper outer quadrant. Okay, and then we can move to the lower outer quadrant.
Okay, so now we've taken sections of our areas of interest, including the lumpectomy cavity. We've taken sections of representative of each quadrant, so I think we're pretty much done here, and we can submit these for processing.
Okay.
So to summarize, we've discussed the different types of mastectomies, and we've discussed how to orient them, ink them, and how important it is to know the patient's prior history and any biopsies or surgical procedures. We've discussed the ways that we section the specimen and sections to take. And do you have any further questions?
I did have a question about the submission of the lumpectomy site. We only submitted representative sections here. What occurs if we see that there is DCIS in one of our sections or at a margin?
Well, we can see what we have. We can always go back and submit additional sections and submit the remainder of the lumpectomy cavity or submit any additional tissue that's available. So we do keep the specimen oriented when we put it back in formalin.
Okay.
In this video, we've discussed grossing various types of breast specimens, which include lumpectomies that were localized with a J-wire, as well as radioactive seeds, and a mastectomy specimen. We've discussed using the Faxitron X-ray to identify biopsy clips and radioactive seeds. We've also discussed the importance of knowing adequate clinical information, as well as imaging and prior pathology prior to receiving and grossing the specimen. We hope you enjoyed this video. Justin, thank you for your help.
Thanks, Dr. Alfonso.
And thank you for your attention.